we is back, we is back, we is back. But yeah, y'all, it's your girl, the OG Pretty Pink Pilot, back with another banger. And today, I am going to do Checkride Binder, all of that good stuff. Boy, let's get into it. So go ahead and like, comment, and subscribe. Turn on your post notifications because we're getting active on this channel, y'all. We about to go into commercial, then the CFI, and we just going to keep it pushing, y'all. But yeah, let's go ahead and get right into it. Waste no time. We're going to talk about it. The famous Checkride Binder. Sorry, y'all. I'm crazy. I'm just gonna pretty much take you guys through my Checkride Binder. I'm gonna insert clips so you guys can see it over here, or over there, or up here, or right, just right there, anywhere. First part of my Checkride Binder is my written. The written exam is in the front because they're gonna ask you for that first. If they didn't, you know, actually use the document, because a lot of DPEs ask for stuff and they don't utilize it. I have both my private and my instrument written in here just in case, because, you know, I don't want anything to stop me from taking my test. Those are the codes that I actually had in the notebook I showed in the previous video. Notebook that had all of my missed questions. So pretty much here, this aligns with the codes that are on the written. As long as you study those, that gives you a good idea of at least the basis of the questions at the least that you're going to be asked on the Checkride. Then we're going to move on to the weather portion. So before I even get to my Checkride, the day before, like here on the 29th at 11:13, I got an Outlook briefing. And then again, at 8 o'clock, I got a Outlook briefing. And then the morning before, I got an Outlook briefing. I also got, you know, a standard briefing closer to the time. Okay, I also have my B speed sheet in here. My B speeds are so important for you to know. I just keep it in there just in case I need a reference, easy, quick, you know, you're able to utilize this. It's not an FAA document, but it's just a sheet that I printed out and I put all my information on there, like how many horsepowers it is, because my Cessna versus other Cessnas have more horsepower than, you know, the regular Cessna. I have go around procedure. This is something I use in my private Checkride as well. So I just pretty much took one page out and put in another. Then I have my IFR minimums. You want to make sure you know your minimums, because if they ask you, oh, what are your minimums? And you're like, you didn't think about your minimums. Then that's a prime example of what you don't want to do in a Checkride. Because he's like, you don't got no minimums? You don't got no minimums? You just gonna fly? Overcast 200? Yeah, no. So you want to just have your minimums. For me, my minimums were 1,000 feet ceilings, and well, 1,000 foot ceilings, and then 4 statute miles visibility. That was just me. Then you just also have your crosswind component. I have 8 knots. You know, it's up to you personally on what you want. Then I just signed it. You also can get your CFI to sign it. My CFI didn't sign this. I didn't use it on my Checkride. A lot of this stuff I didn't use on this Checkride, but I used it on my first one. So you just go to different DPEs and they ask different questions. So don't just not bring something because you don't think like he's going to ask you, because he would. Another thing that I have in here is the chart supplement for the airport I'm flying out of and the airport that I'm going to. I just have both of them in here. I highlighted, like, you know, the ATIS, tower frequency, different things that I might need to know. And then also the same for Statesboro, the communications I needed for there. Moving on to the airport diagram. I always print out the airport diagram. I think it is important for you to have, just so you can see the airport layout, not only on your iPad, but also the hard copy, you know, in your binder. So I just, you know, highlight the important things, like the runway lengths, where I would be, you know, having my Checkride at, or the valid period of this document. Because if it's not a current document, you're not able to use it on your Checkride. So you want to make sure that all your documents are current on your Checkride. That is something I want to highlight for you. Some DPs are more understanding than others, but you always want to just come in with the best chance of walking out there, which helps cert. Because we spend too much time, it's too much money to be messing up so close to that. Next, Savannah Airport. I knew that's the one I would be flying at. So I just wrote down the elevation, traffic pattern, teardrop, if I had to do a teardrop over the airport, what airspace it was, etc., etc. Then we go into your international flight plan. I just printed one out and wrote it down. I'm here to help you guys not do what I did. And one thing that I did on my Checkride was I actually did not bring a nav log. I brought one on my flight plan for 4th flight, but I did not bring like a hard copy. So when he asked me about my nav log, I was kind of like, Like, if you're gonna bring Four Flight to your Checkride, make sure you know Four Flight really, really well. You watch a video on Four Flight, have some reference to Four Flight, have your instructor go over Four Flight with you. Because you don't want to bring something and not be able to utilize it the way you thought you would. Because that could have been a moment where I could have, you know, been like discontinued because, like, you know, I didn't even know where my nav log was, you know? Something as simple as that. Next are NOTAMs. NOTAMs are so important for flying in general, but for especially for instrument training or instrument flights. There's so many NOTAMs, and you have to figure out which NOTAMs apply to you, how you can utilize it, how is it going to affect your flight, like, if you're going to be using that approach even, like, it's so much. A lot of times on Four Flight, they'll actually give you, like, the NOTAMs that you actually need when you pull up the plate. You're able to click that, or, like, when you pull up the airport. But don't get complacent on that. You know, NOTAMs are very important. You can fly into an airspace and have to get a phone number. And nobody wants to get a phone number. Nobody wants to get a phone number. Because then it's like your career is on the line. And who wants to do that, you know? Nobody. All right. And next, I have pretty much my breakdown for ENG airspace. Those were like the hardest for me to do. So I just, you know, wrote them down. I found this YouTube video. I use this for my private as well. I just copied it over, put it in this notebook. Like I said, I'm extra. So I did have airspace notes for, like, you know, the military operating areas, Savannah Airport, and outer core looked like, how far it was, the restricted area, where it stopped, where it started, rate of descent equation, and my feet per nautical mile to feet per minute conversion, which wasn't necessarily important for me and my Checkride, but you never know. You always want to have those equations or something to go back on. And if it's in your notebook, it gives you one less thing to have to go to your iPad for, to have to ask, you know, Google what this is. Because you can't use your iPad on your Checkride, you just don't want to milk it, you know. Also have my performance data sheet that showed me my performance data, like how many my gallons per hour I was going to use, my true airspeed, things of that nature. You also want to make sure you get your pressure altitude, your density altitude, and your maneuvering speed. Those are all things that I get on my weight and balance sheet. It is just a thorough weight and balance sheet to me. It covers everything. My zero fuel weight, my ramp weight, my takeoff weight, my landing weight. And then, like, runway distances. Everything's on this one sheet. One reference. Boom. It's right there. Inspection dates for my aircraft. The last one that was done and the next one that will be done for my aircraft. So if he asks you, like, oh, when do you need the next one? Boom, it's already there because I already wrote it out. And I know the time period. I'll write them down, but some of them I just remember as well. The thing that I brought on my Checkride was this memorandum that was put out about interpretation of a part of the FAR. There's a part of the FAR aim that says that you have to do a 250 nautical mile cross country, and it has to be three different approaches at three different airports. One being like 100 nautical miles, something like that. Don't quote me on that. Make sure you go read up on it before you do. It's 6165. So just go look in there and it'll be able to tell you exactly what it is. But pretty much the interpretation that they had for it was wrong, and that it doesn't have to be an ILS, a VOR, and an NDB. It can be an ILS at one airport, an ILS at another airport, and then a VOR, you know? So I just wanted to make sure if there ever was questions about, like, oh, you didn't do this requirement, that I had the memorandum here and I had my receipts, y'all. You want to have your receipts, even with the DPs, because sometimes you think that this person is, like, so elite. And they know everything. They do know everything. But there's a certain things that they don't know because, you know, they're out of touch. They're not in training. So I wanted to make sure that if there ever was a question, that I had this paper that pretty much said that I'm straight, you know? Cross your T's, dot your I's, because it's your money, it's your license, it's your career on the line at the end of the day. And then we go into the engine portion, type classifications. I have the whole POH printed out, and I also printed out diagrams of the altimeter, all the instruments I printed out diagrams for, because I just wanted to make sure that I had a reference there to know. He didn't ask me how the inside of the gyros work or how the inside of the pitot system works. He asked me about a pitot blockage. I'm like ice blocking on your pitot tube. Also do this thing where I write a little engine blurb. That's what I call it. This is just like a little couple sentence long to understand the different parts of the system. So I have propeller, oil system, engine, I have carburetor system, fuel system, electrical, and brake system. Just like a couple little sentences so I can explain it to them in layman terms so they can understand what I'm talking about. Another thing that I did was an instrument blurb. The same thing I did for the engine, I did it for the instruments. Because when you're in instrument, you have to have a better understanding of the wafers and the inner workings of the instrument. So you don't want to get things misconstrued or, you know, not be able to explain how the inside of the system works because, you know, you're flying in the cloud. You need to know how your plane is working. Just, you know, wrote that down just so I can have a better understanding. Printed out the NOTAMs for my aircraft, which ones are recurring. Sorry, y'all. I printed out the airworthiness directives that you need for my aircraft. I have a recurring one, which is a seat track rail inspection. So then I'll go to that part of the logs and show that they did a seat track inspection. Boom, you're crossing your T's, you're dotting your I's, you're doing things that he's not even asking you to do. And he's gonna be like, what? This girl, is she already an instrument rated pilot or what? You know? And then another thing that I didn't really know, the rotating beacon, the different lights, what they mean on the ground or in the air. I have some acronyms in here that I also utilize. Some weather review, because weather was like one of those harder things for me to do. Last but not least, the bread and butter of Part 61 training, which is the ACS. This allows for you to see the questions that you got wrong on your written, how your check ride is going to be structured, all the questions that's going to be asking you, the standards that they're going to have. Everything you can think about is in the ACS. If you know the ACS, then you are going to pass your check right. I can almost 99.5% guarantee that if you go over this ACS, you will be assured for your check right. You will be very prepared. Yeah, that's pretty much the breakdown of my check right binder.